Neil Thompson. I'm the director of the Future Tech Project here at the Computer Science and AI Lab at MIT. And we have some questions about Moore's Law and AI that I'm going to be answering today. As we approach physical limitations of silicon-based chip technology, is Moore's Law still relevant? So I think this is a really important question, because for decades and decades, computing has been shaped by Moore's Law, this pattern where, as we miniaturized our transistors, these fundamental pieces of the chip, as we miniaturized them, that allowed us to put more and more transistors on them, and that made our computers much more powerful, and they used those smaller transistors used less energy so we could run chips faster. And this just meant that there were all kinds of things that we could do today that we just could not do in the past. As you shrink these things, at some point you get down to the atomic level, and you get to this point where you say, well, now all of a sudden we have quantum effects and other things that are going to start interfering with the way our transistors work, and that's going to be a real challenge to making them ever smaller and making them ever better. And in fact, back in 2004 and 2005, we already lost a big part of that gain when we stopped our ability to speed up the processors that we were using. Now, we're still getting the last vestiges of Moore's Law. We can still miniaturize these transistors more, and so we're still getting more transistors, we just can't run them as fast. And people may be aware that we're having these problems now where sometimes you have to like turn off parts of your chips, sometimes called dark silicon, in order to not use all the power at the same time and produce too much that would heat up the chip. So then the question is, like, is Moore's Law still relevant? And the answer is it's relevant for some people, but not for others. Already those people who where the speed increase was the important thing, they've already lost a lot of the benefit. And that's actually, unfortunately, many of us, right? If you're running a lot of programs on your computer, a lot of the things you do, you care mostly about how fast you can run them. And we've already lost a lot of that benefit. There are, however, still some people who are doing really advanced stuff, like some of the stuff in AI, and those AI chips are really using lots and lots of transistors, and so they're still taking advantage of it. So that'll still go on for a little while. Our cell phones are another example, but we already see this narrowing of the people who are benefiting from Moore's Law, and we don't have that much longer until it's going to run out. What new materials like graphene or technologies like 3D stacking and chip design might contribute to the trend of Moore's Law beyond the limitations of silicon? Unfortunately, the answer here is that it's pretty hard to know which of these technologies are going to win. And there are a couple of reasons why that's true. So there are some technologies that are clear are going to be useful in the short term. So 3D stacking is this idea that previously mostly our chips were sort of like a plane. So it was just like, and it was now we might be more like building it up. So you can imagine sort of building high rises rather than having low rise houses or things like that. And as we build them up, we get more and more transistors. That will definitely give us some advantages, and we're already using that in computer memory. The problem is that when we run these transistors on our processors, they produce heat, and that's been the limitation for decades and decades. That production of heat limits how fast we can run them. And the problem is, of course, that if you start stacking these things on top of each other and they're all producing heat, now it's harder to get that heat away. And so I think 3D stacking will be useful in some places, but not that much in others. Another short-term technology that may matter here as well is this idea of what's sometimes called chiplets. And it's this idea that rather than designing each of our chips brand new, we might build chips and sort of stick them together like Legos. And again, that has the possibility for some small gains in the short run because it allows us to be a little bit more modular and save some costs. But it doesn't give us the same kind of scale of benefits that we had from Moore's Law. Now, in the longer term, we have other things like spintronics and graphene and other things that people may have heard of. Those things, some of them have a lot of promise, but it's really very untested. These are all early stage technologies. And one of the things that I've been talking to policymakers about that I think is really important is that we're just investing far too little in generating these next generation technologies. So I would say that we probably need to be investing maybe 10 or 100 times as much money as the United States as we are right now. So this is a real shortfall. And if we don't invest, we're going to have this longer and longer gap until these next technologies get here. And that's going to mean that the benefits that we get for computing, we're just not going to get them for much, much longer. And so that's a real deficit that I really think the government should try and address. And I hope that we can, you know, get the word out that this is a really important thing to talk about. In the context of slowing hardware advancements, what are the key algorithmic innovations in AI that continue to drive its success? So this is a really interesting and important question, because if Moore's Law is slowing, as I've told you, right, why is it that we're seeing this incredible explosion in AI and how good it is? And the answer is a couple of things are going on at the same time. So one is that AI is better able to take advantage of computer hardware than most types of things that we run. That's just because it can do more calculations in parallel. And parallel is something computers do really well, and AI uses a lot of. Most of the things we run don't have that much parallelism, and so it's hard to get that full advantage of it. Another is just that AI as an area actually is making very rapid progress in algorithms as well, and so that's a big advantage that's coming in too. But the biggest thing that's driving AI right now is actually we're just spending more and more money to do these models. And so it used to be, if you look at a cutting edge model from the 1970s, what people are running it on is just a couple of processors, right? So think about, you know, buying a computer, and you might have a computer, or you might have a few computers, but it was running on a relatively small amount of hardware. Today, when people train GPT-4, for example, they're running on tens of thousands of chips at the same time, and they're not running them for hours, they're running them for weeks or even months. And so there's just a huge amount more resources we're putting in, and that's a big, big part of why AI is accelerating, even in the face of Moore's Law not giving us the efficiency improvements that we used to have. How sustainable is Moore's Law progression in light of rising costs and environmental concerns? Is there a limit to its economic and or environmental viability? It's hard to overstate how important Moore's Law has been for the economic and environmental sustainability of computing. If you go back and talk to some of the people who were at the very early days of computing, they're often saying things like, we knew that you could have video conferencing, we knew that you could do these really complicated things, we just knew we didn't have enough computing power. And it was just totally unreasonable to say, we're gonna spend so much money or devote so many resources to do these things, and so they just didn't do them. And it took decades of computers getting better for those things to get into reach and for us to say, okay, now that's reasonably affordable. Now that's an amount of resources we could actually imagine spending on this problem. And the challenge we have today is that as Moore's Law slows down, we've lost that efficiency gain, right? Getting twice as many transistors for the same amount of dollars or for the same amount of resources was a huge benefit. And so for decades and decades, we saw Moore's Law was sort of driving the improvement that we had. But as I just told you, in AI, that's not the case. The way we're doing in AI is we are actually scaling that up. And that means there's a big environmental and economic cost that is coming into these models. And people have estimated that GPT-4, for example, cost $100 million to train. And people are preparing to spend 10 or 100 times as much in some of the coming models that are going. So these are enormously expensive systems that they're building. And we should start to worry because those big systems with all of those resources also produce more greenhouse gases, and that becomes less and less sustainable for us. And so I think one of the things we need to do is say, well, if we're not getting that improvement from Moore's Law and we are scaling these things up in this way, what are the other things that we can do in order to make these chips more environmentally and economically efficient? And people are working on that. There's a lot of really interesting algorithm work going on in these areas. But it's a real challenge in order to meet, because right now we're scaling up even faster than we're able to do that. With the end of Moore's Law, are we approaching a fundamental shift in the economic model of the tech industry? I think not only are we moving to a different economic model, but we're actually moving back to an economic model that looks a lot more like the things in our regular lives and away from a model that was really just very different and very unusual. So if I told you, oh, imagine we have a motor, you would say, okay, I can imagine a motor, but the motors that I picture look awfully different, right? The motor that's on a plane is huge and powerful. The one that is in a blender is sort of moderately powerful. And the one that is in like a fan that is blowing on you is not very powerful at all. There's enormous differences in the materials and the design choices that are made for those different types of motors. Historically, for computer chips, we have not had this kind of specialization. Computer chips, we built these CPUs, these central processing units, and they've been designed to do everything. In fact, if you talk to Intel architects, they'll tell you that these chips are a compromise so that they do everything well. And we've had this remarkable durability of not specializing, of having just a single technology that we use for all kinds of things, right? And that, you know, in the rest of the world, that would seem odd. Imagine a motor that you put in your plane when you go in an airplane, and then you put on your blender when you get home. Like, that's a very different world. And so the reason that we were able to have that for so long is precisely because computers were getting better so fast that it wasn't worth specializing it, because you'd say, well, I would get some benefit of specializing it, but then I'm going to get that benefit from Moore's law in a year or two anyway, and so I'd rather just wait and use this generic technology that we can all take advantage of. Okay, so the question asked about this economic shift, what's happening? Well, as Moore's law slows down, now we need to start specializing, and we're going to start specializing in computer chips in just the way that we do in almost every other product in our lives. And that means we're going to have chips that are specifically designed for our phones. We already have those. Chips that are designed for AI, okay, we already have those as well, but we're also going to get all kinds of other chips coming in. And so this is a real departure for it. And, you know, there are horror stories of people in the 70s and 80s who thought specialization is the thing of that moment, and it wasn't because of Moore's law. Now all of those people are finally getting their moment, and all the specialization is happening. The great part about that is, like, as we do that specialization, there are some gains that we can get from it. The hard part about it is that we're going to get this fragmentation, right? We're no longer going to have a single operating system that works on these things, a single programming language that used it. You're going to get all kinds of differences, and things are going to become much more specialized, and that's going to be a lot more complicated for the industry and for all of us as well. As we approach the limits of Moore's law, how do you see the role of software optimizations in advancing computing capabilities? So this same benefit that we were just talking about of Moore's law, meaning that everyone's stuck with the same chip, those gains were also really used by software designers in the past. And in particular, they were used to design software that was very modular. So imagine this, you might have like a particular programming language or a particular set of code that is, for example, talking to the hardware, right? It might be the operating system, or is talking to some external device or something like that. You would design that and you would say, if another program wants to talk to it, if it wants to say, hey, I want to use the microphone on your phone or something like that, right? It calls that other program and says, do this for me and send me back the answer. And there's this very nice clean interface that says, you only have to tell me these few details and I'll take care of everything else behind the scenes. The problem is that when you do this, you often pay a cost in terms of efficiency, that it's often maybe like in your program, you're doing analysis at one level, and then you have to convert, maybe you have to convert the data, or you have to convert the way that you're handling stuff into another form so that you can use this interface that you have. So that's very inefficient, but it can be very worthwhile if it makes programming easier. As long as Moore's law is giving us this benefit year after year of making it cheaper and cheaper to run our chips. As Moore's law ends, we lose that gain. And so now, if you want to make your programs more efficient, you're going to want to take back that modularization, that inefficiency that you were willing to build in to make programming these things easier. You're going to take that back in order to make running them more efficient. And so I think that's a big thing that people are going to be doing. And in some of the work that we've published in Science, we've shown that in some particular cases, there can be enormous gains from taking back that efficiency. How will the slowing or potential end of Moore's law impact the development of AI and big data analytics, which are heavily dependent on increasing computational power? So much of what we're doing right now to scale up AI is actually just spending a lot more money to build more chips and run more chips for longer, that in the short run, the change in Moore's law is not going to have much of an effect because we're scaling up so rapidly. But as these models get more and more expensive, and GPT-4, it's costing about $100 million to train, and people are expecting the next generations to be 10 or 100 times more expensive, right? We are definitely going to get to limits where we say these models are getting very, very expensive to build. And then the lack of Moore's law is really going to hurt us, because what you hope and what we have traditionally had is that even if you introduce something that was very expensive, over time it got much, much cheaper. So for example, in the early days of computing, NASA paid for a lot of computing power on the spaceship. But today, that amount of computing is available for much, much less because of this progress that has come from Moore's law. What we would hope is that that would happen in AI as well. And we will get some of it because AI is also improving in terms of its software efficiency and algorithmic efficiency, but not having the hardware part is going to be a big challenge.